WordWise, where we delve deeply in the Word of God, discover what it means, and then how to apply it to our lives. We're continuing and finishing our little time in John 11 this week in the study of how Jesus responds to faith and doubt, and how faith and doubt exist together so often. It's normal. It's just part of our life, and part of being a Christian is to learn to strengthen your faith and grow that faith muscle stronger and deal with those doubts, address them honestly and openly, and seek the answers to the questions you may have, and understand that doubt is normal, just an everyday part of living in Jesus. So today we're looking at John 11, continuing the passage we started the last couple weeks, and it's John 11, verses 35 through 44. So read along with us as we see a mighty miracle that Jesus performed and the reactions that came to the situation from Martha and so many others. Read with us John 11, 35 through 44.
Then Jesus wept. The people who were standing nearby said, "See how much he loved him?" But some said, "This man healed a blind man. Couldn't he have kept Lazarus from dying?" Jesus was still angry as he arrived at the tomb, a cave with a stone rolled across its entrance. "Roll the stone aside," Jesus told them. But Martha, the dead man's sister, protested, "Lord, he has been dead for 4 days. The smell will be terrible." Jesus responded, "Didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believe?" So they rolled the stone aside. Then Jesus looked up to heaven and said, "Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me, but I said it out loud for the sake of all these people standing here, so that they will believe you sent me." Then Jesus shouted, "Lazarus, come out!" And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a headcloth. Jesus told them, "Unwrap him and let him go."
So as we continue this passage, remind you to look back at the previous sections to sort of remind yourself of the context and the background, or go ahead and watch those earlier episodes of WordWise. But Jesus has been ministering to Mary and Martha, two good friends who lost their brother Lazarus, and he had just had a conversation with Martha and Mary, and now he's going to visit the grave, going to visit the tomb where Lazarus has been interred for 4 days, we're told in the earlier sections of this chapter. And in the meantime, he's been dealing with some pretty strong emotions. And I love the way Jesus handles emotion, both in the people he ministers to and with, but also in himself. He doesn't try to hide those strong emotions. He doesn't try to rationalize them away or pretend they're not there. He openly weeps in verse 35. And we know the reason for that, but the crowd doesn't. And so the crowd notices that, and several of them remark that, gee, it's because he misses Lazarus so much. He misses his friend Lazarus so very much. Now, we know that's not the reason, because Jesus has predicted and has already been very clear that he's going to resurrect Lazarus. And we know, and Jesus knows, that's going to happen in just a few minutes. So it's not because he misses Lazarus that he's weeping. We know that he's weeping because of some strong emotions he has, anger, indignant feelings that he has against death and the havoc that death can wreak upon us and the pain that it causes all humanity. And Jesus is seeing that pain close up and personal here in Mary, Martha, and so many friends of Lazarus, and so many people who've come to grieve and visit and spend time with those who have been bereft here. Jesus feels that intense anger. In fact, it's revisited as he gets to the tomb. It strengthens even again as he's just angry at this reality. But as always, there are cynics and skeptics in the crowd, and they're saying, well, didn't this Jesus, didn't he heal a blind man? I mean, didn't he do that great miracle? Why couldn't he have healed his friend Lazarus? I mean, obviously he doesn't care. Obviously he doesn't really have the power or something else is going on, but he could have done something. And that always exists, both in a crowd and in us sometimes. We always have that feeling, that struggle between faith and doubt, and that questioning side of us is always there. The deal is, how do you address it? Do you let your doubts be known, and do you work through them honestly and openly, or do you try to hide them? Faith is a muscle that needs to be strengthened, and that's what we've seen Mary doing and Martha doing, and Jesus encourages that. So he goes to the tomb, and it's a cave with a stone placed across it. It's pretty traditional for that time, especially for a man of influence and probably wealth like Lazarus. He would have had a tomb prepared ahead of time, and it would have been a rather good place for him to be buried. 4 days have gone by. A Jewish myth that we don't know if Jesus was even aware of it at the time, but a Jewish myth existed that the spirit of a person, once they died, would stick around for up to 3 days and would kind of linger in the vicinity. as kind of just part of that disconnection from the physical body. We don't know if the disciples and Jesus were aware of that or not, but it's an ancient myth that existed in Judaism. So Jesus has waited 4 days just to make sure that everyone knows this is not just a revival of a dead person or any kind of sickness or he was unconscious or anything like that. No, it's 4 days, possibly to address that myth, possibly just to prove the power that Jesus has. And we know Jesus has done other resurrections before. That's documented in the Gospels. But this one is even more significant. It's an adult male, a man of great influence and probably wealth and had a lot of friends and neighbors and business connections. And a lot of people had come to grieve and to show respect to the deceased. And so this is a large crowd. This is a huge public spectacle that's happening. And Jesus has many witnesses that are going to see this mighty miracle. So as he gets there, he says, "Roll away the stone." And I love that there's a response. Martha, the practical, logical one, still wrestling between faith and doubt, still wanting to believe and wanting to know. She's already confirmed her belief that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. She's affirmed that he is the resurrection and the life. She knows that he is powerful and that he is a miracle-working, powerful Messiah. But yet, she still has that practical, logical side that says, remember, Lord, he's been in the grave for a long time, and you may not want to do this because it's going to be unpleasant in some pretty significant ways. I love the fact that Jesus just addresses that directly. He doesn't rebuke her for that comment. No, he just reminds her, hey, remember, I told you you'd be witness to a glorious and amazing happening, that God would receive much glory, and the Son of God would be confirmed as this amazing Messiah that you've believed in. I told you if you would just believe, you would witness something spectacular. And so that's what he just reminds her of that. And then he prays. And I love the prayer. It's pretty simple. Just reaches out in prayer to the Father and just prays out loud so that people will hear this prayer. And he's basically just reminding himself and others that the whole purpose of a miracle is to confirm that Jesus is who he says he is, and that he is sent by God, and that he is Messiah, and he does have the authority that was given to him by God the Father, and that he is who he says he is, and everything he said and did can be trusted and can be believed in, and that's the purpose of the miracles, just to confirm that. And this being the greatest of the miracles, as portrayed in the Gospel of John, comes as the last major miracle here. And then he says in verse 43 some pretty simple words, doesn't he? There's no abracadabra or long drawn-out process. There's no sort of extended version of this. No, he just says, "Lazarus, come out." He speaks just a few words, and notice the response is instantaneous. There's not a long delay. There's not several hours of waiting or speculation as to what's going to happen. No, the dead man emerges no longer dead. Lazarus walks out of the tomb. And I love the little detail that John gives us. He's still in the grave cloths. He's still in the wrappings that they would have prepared his body and wrapped his body, including the head cloth. Now, when later Jesus will be resurrected, his resurrection is different. He's being resurrected in a glorified body, and his resurrection is different because the grave cloths were left behind as an evidence of the resurrection, as a reminder of the resurrection, because there wasn't a crowd of witnesses waiting outside the tomb like there was for this situation. And Lazarus is resurrected back into a physical body, and he doesn't have that special status of a glorified body yet. He's still back in his physical body, and he emerges unable to break free of those grave cloths. He's unable to break free in his own power. And I love that Jesus notices that. Verse 44, as we close, Jesus notices that. And even in the midst of this amazing miracle, even in the midst of this incredible spectacle, imagine the response of the crowd, Mary and Martha and everybody who was there, jumping up and down and screaming with joy and jubilation breaking forth. And yet Jesus notices, hey, he needs to be freed from these grave cloths. He needs to be unwrapped and freed from this. And he cares that much that even this little detail, he reminds the crowd, hey, somebody needs to help him out. And he cares that much, not only to resurrect his friend Lazarus, and to give him back to his family and friends, but a little detail of freeing him from those impediments. The reality, brothers and sisters, is that's our God. That's Jesus. He's a miracle-working God. He's almighty and all-powerful, but he's also personal and caring in some pretty significant ways. So today, remember that faith and doubt exist together, that sometimes God will do these amazing, spectacular miracles in your life, Other times the miracles will be a little less dramatic and maybe a little more difficult to notice. But God is always working. God is always answering our prayers and seeking to help us. We just need to be aware that He is working and open to Him helping us. And then remember, faith and doubt are going to exist together. Lean into the faith, trust God more as we walk by faith, not by sight. Thanks for joining us today.